This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Kevin Randle is with us today. He is one of the leading, if not the leading, researcher on the Roswell incident and knew most of the principals in this case personally and very well. He's here today to talk about AARO's most recent release of information, supposedly. And we're going to talk about that in the context of a post-mortem affidavit left behind by press officer Walter Haut, who was the press officer at the Roswell Army Airfield when the Roswell incident occurred. Now, can you tell us first? Well, first, I want to say that Kevin has a new book out, Roswell's in the 21st Century, a number of new books, Understanding Roswell also. You can reach him at kevinrandle.blogspot.com, where you will find one of the most extraordinary troves of research about Roswell in the world, if not the most extraordinary one. Roswell in the 21st Century is particularly important right now because it goes through the whole history of this affidavit that we're going to be talking about. Now, if you go on Wikipedia and look up Walter Haut, you will find a lot of misinformation about that affidavit and an attempt, even they call it an affidavit in quotes, even an attempt to disparage it. They can't debunk it exactly, but they do attempt to disparage it. Wikipedia, remember, can be edited by anybody, and you may be sure that the Wikipedia organization will welcome editors from the intelligence community, not necessarily knowing what they are. And the overall bias of Wikipedia against UFO research of all kinds is fundamental to its to the way it exposes itself to the public. Just like ChatGPT or Claude, they're all like that, and they shouldn't be. But anyway, welcome, Kevin, to your show. Pardon my rant, folks.
Well, that's okay, and I'm glad we were able to finally make the connection.
Yeah, we had some very mysterious trouble, but who knows? My listeners won't even be interested in that. We have so many weird things happen on this show. But in any case, we're together now. It's working fine, so let's get to it. All right. Tell us a little bit first. Let's just go over a little bit about Walter Haut, and you've met him, and tell us a little bit about the man as he was during his life.
Well, Walter Haut was, of course, in the Army Air Forces during the Second World War. I believe he was a bombardier. He was wounded in action. Once the war was ended and the 509th was transferred to Roswell Army Airfield from, I think it was Tinian, he took over the job as sort of an aide to Colonel Blanchard, who was the commanding officer. Colonels aren't really authorized aides. Those go to general officers. But as the public affairs officer, public relations officer, he took over some of that duty. So he was well acquainted with Colonel Blanchard as that. According to his original story, when I first met him, which was, boy, I hate to say it, it's more than 30 years ago, he had just said he wrote the press release, and that's all he knew. That was it. He wrote the press release. He said in various interviews, discussions with me, he wasn't sure whether Blanchard called him and dictated it to him over the phone, or if he went to Blanchard's office and took notes.
Kevin, there was a disruption. Could you repeat what you just said?
I was saying that Walter, in my discussions with him, didn't remember whether he wrote the press release himself, whether Blanchard dictated it to him over the phone, or he went to Blanchard's office and took notes and then brought it back to the office and created the press release. And he may have written it, or one of the NCOs in the office may have written the actual document. And then he took it to the four media outlets in Roswell, which were two newspapers, the morning paper, the Dispatch, and the afternoon paper, the Daily Record, and to the news, two radio stations, Frank Joyce and George Walsh, and they put it on the, they both put it on various news wires. And that was when the story came out in the newspapers on July 8th, 1947. From that point on, within days of that, the story was killed by the idea that it was nothing more than a weather balloon. And nobody really was talking about that until Jesse Marcel, who was the base intelligence officer, had talking on ham radio to his friends, mentioned that he'd picked up pieces of a flying saucer. He did that, mentioned that in 1978. And from that point on, we began to learn more about what was going on in Roswell. Walter Haut did one thing that was really great. In 1947, they created a yearbook of most of the people who were at the base at the time. He said they missed 10 or 15% of the people, but it gave us a list of around 1,500 people who were there and may have been involved. And using that list, Don Schmidt, Tom Carey, and I, Stan Friedman, Bill Moore, others reached out to various people to see what they knew about the events in Roswell. And that was how we gathered a great deal of that information from the people who were there in 1947.
Well, I've seen that, yes. And I met Walter, and he was, I asked him point blank the questions that he answers in this affidavit. Were there bodies, and was there a craft, were there debris? And he answered equivocally, but not no in any case. And at the time, I had not yet, I met a number of people who have had hands-on with this stuff. Dr. Robert Sauerbacher, who I met on the telephone, not personally. My uncle Mickey, who was at Wright Field when the debris was brought there. General Arthur Exon, who was there too, and both of them gave me extensive information about what had happened and what they had done. And General Exon told another member of my family about one of the bodies. He didn't tell me personally that he had seen and held in his arms. And so there were others. But Walter struck me as being not deceptive, but contained. Let me put it this way. It was obvious he was keeping secrets. And my uncle, too. General Exon was the most open of these men. But my uncle said to me, "Have you seen the materials?" And I knew from the way that works in among people in the military, if I had been able to describe the materials that I knew to be that at that point in time, this was 88, in a hangar in Florida, which my uncle had been in, I would have, if I had been able to describe them, then he would have been willing to talk to me more fully about it. But he wasn't, because I couldn't, because I hadn't been there. Okay, so get this thing from AARO. What are they trying to accomplish, do you think? Because it is a rollback to the Project Blue Book days. And it's impossible not to conclude that a lot of it is just intentional, blatant lying. And you get to the point where you don't think anyone except maybe CNN and the New York Times and places like that are going to pick it up. I don't even think NPR is going to take it very seriously. So what are they doing?
Well, if you look at the history as they laid it out in the AARO report, I think most of us in the UFO community have been around a long time, understand this history, that there have been times when the investigation of UFOs seemed to be legitimate. They were actually searching for an answer, but those were short-lived. The real emphasis seemed to be on disinformation, directing the public in other arenas. In 1953, there was a panel chaired by H.P. Robertson, sponsored by the CIA, and it was like 5 days, and scientists were looking at the evidence that Project Blue Book had gathered. And they concluded that there was nothing to this, that teachers should not allow students to write book reports on UFOs, and they shouldn't do project on UFOs. They should just stay away from that because it's not true. The problem with that, and it, I think it was Dr. Michael Swords from the Center for UFO Studies, looked at all of this carefully and realized that the report, the Robertson panel report, was probably written before they took a word of testimony. Because after they finished up on Friday, the next morning, Robertson had a draft of their report all done to be signed off. So it's clear that something was going on. He didn't sit up all night and write this new report. It was done earlier. And it's the same thing with the Condon Committee, which was the University of Colorado study done in 1969 when they ended Project Blue Book. We have the documentation where a guy named Hippler, a science advisor in the Air Force, Lieutenant Colonel Hippler, writes to the Condon Committee and says, here's what we'd like you to find. We'd like you to say that the Air Force did a good job of investigation. There's no threat to national security, and nothing of a scientific value can be learned by continuing to study UFOs. That was before they even started the investigation. And lo and behold, when you get to the end of their investigation and you look at what Condon said, he said, well, you know, the Air Force did a good job of investigating. There's no threat to national security, and there's really nothing of scientific value to be learned at it, by continuing study. One of their reports in the Condon Committee was explained as a natural phenomenon so rare it had never been seen before or since.
And yet they therefore knew it was a natural phenomenon anyway.
Well, but the real point is they're saying there's nothing of scientific value to be learned, and yet here's a natural phenomenon, whatever it might be, that they couldn't explain. It would seem to me that scientific research would be of a benefit there. They didn't look at many of the good cases, like Level Land, which was the November of 1957 case, where literally dozens of people had their cars stalled by this UFO that hovered around for 3 years. There were
one of my neighbors' fathers was in the Level Land case. Yes, I know the case.
But here's a case where car engines were stalled. Radios were interfered with. There were all kinds of people who were involved. What I discovered when I was writing the book on Level Land is that the sheriff of Hockley County, and I always hated his name, Ware Clem, decided to go out to look for himself to see what other people were seeing. There was a deputy with him in his car. Behind him was a car from the Texas Department of Public Safety, which is basically the state police. And what I learned, and behind them was a car with Air Force officers in it. The sheriff said originally in the newspaper reports, they got close enough, he saw a football-shaped object that was bright red and glowing. The next day, according to Don Berlinson, the mechanic, and Berlinson interviewed the mechanic, said that the sheriff brought his car in to have it checked. Well, why would he do that? Because the engine stalled. And if his engine stalled, so did the car behind him, and so did the car with the Air Force officers in it. So we've got this body of evidence that suggests something extremely unusual is going on, and yet every time there's an official investigation, we get an official conclusion, it's the same official conclusion. We're now looking at, I think, what I think of as Twining 3.0. We just haven't gotten any further. Robertson said there was nothing to it. Condon said there was nothing to it. And now the AARO people, Kirkpatrick, says there's nothing to
it. And it's always been false. You know, I knew Walter Orr Roberts, who was the president emeritus of NOAA. He had retired, but when he was still active, he was approached to run what became the Condon Committee by the Air Force before Condon was, because he had a much more distinguished reputation. And he told me they made it clear, and I suppose he probably talked to the same man you just mentioned, that the conclusion was foregone, that there would be that this would be what concluded. And he said, well, I don't know what I'm supposed to do then, because if I'm not going to do any research, what's the point of asking me to be in it at all? All you want is to use my moniker, or whatever he said, not moniker, but he said my credentials, I guess. And he wouldn't do it. But Condon wasn't so concerned about lying as Dr. Roberts was. Wait, we've got to stop for a second for our free Dreamlanders. We got to do a brief break. We are talking to Kevin Randle. His place on the internet is kevinrandle.blogspot.com. If you want to get into this deeply, and you should, especially what we're going to be talking about with regard to Walter Haut's posthumous affidavit about this. We're going to get into that in detail in a few minutes. You need to get Roswell, the 21st Century by Kevin Randle. And he's also got another book out recently called Understanding Roswell. We'll be right back. My new book, Them, has now been out since March of 2023. I would like to thank everyone for the wonderful reception. Those who have read it, who have posted thoughtful reviews on Amazon, those who have listened. It's an important book for me. And also, over the months, it has become a very strange book, because if you listen to the Oversight Committee UAP hearings, you will hear David Grush saying things that almost sound like they were taken right out of the second part of Them. And I thought to myself, how did I do that? The answer is, I have no idea. But the book is really very prophetic, and I think you should read it if you hadn't done so. And that's what this is all about. Read it, listen to it. It's really worth your time. Jacques Vallée certainly thought so. Mitch Horowitz thought so. Jeff Kripal thought so. Leslie Kane, Diana Pasolka, and all of the others who gave it blurbs thought so. And so do an awful lot of people who have reviewed it. So pick up a copy today. Go to Amazon and get a copy. Go to Audible and get the audiobook. Listen to them. Read them. It's a whole new vision of how we should think about the close encounter experience. And this is getting more and more important over time. More and more important. Them. I saw the future when I was writing that book. Didn't know I would, but I did. You can read it now and see for yourself. This is a brief excerpt from an interview with two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes. Actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young. I believe that it was kind of blonde, and he was very tall, like at least six feet, and he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him. Or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months, and I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more. Not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com. Plus everything else that we offer, my audio books, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful revelation show and its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical mysterious powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure. Learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com. Click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today. We're talking to Kevin Randle. Kevin's web presence is kevinrandle.blogspot.com. Okay, so we're in a situation now where the government's line that goes back to 1969 has, after the gutting of the Schumer Amendment, thanks to a congressman who is supported by the defense community, once they've gutted it, they could do this. Now, is it they're in some there? It's not quite a lie, though. It is a deception, really, more than a lie. In other words, they don't ever say, they say certain things that make it look unimportant, even though it's not. It's very cleverly done. And I'm wondering if you know anything about the way the defense industry is essentially using the Department of Defense to defend itself against the public, because that's exactly what's happening.
Well, I know as an Air Force and former Air Force and Army intelligence officer, I know in my job, there were times when I would get calls from reporters about something that was in the news, and they were looking for some kind of an official statement. And I would always tell them, well, I don't know what you're talking about. Because if I said anything at all, then they would say verified by spokesman so-and-so, or Kevin Randle said this, as a way of validating what they said. With the Condon Committee, what I wanted to say earlier was Condon said in like 18 months before the project ended, he was in Corning, New York, talking to scientists, and he said, well, I don't think there's anything to this, but I'm not supposed to learn that for another 18 months.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we see this collusion between the scientific community, I guess, and the military on misdirecting the interest in UFOs. They say things that are almost true, that are close to true, and misdirect where we're going and where we're looking. And I think this latest AARO report is another example of that. They don't really say that there's nothing to UFOs. They say we found no empirical evidence of that.
Yeah, they didn't, but that doesn't mean it's not there, because after all, remember this, all of the Roswell records from the Roswell Air Base from 1947 to 1952 were alleged by the Air Force when the General Accounting Office attempted to respond to a congressional question to be lost. Therefore, they can't, they're saying not that it's not there, it doesn't exist, but they can't find it. That's essentially correct, isn't it?
Well, and they sometimes answer the question precisely. If you say to them, do you know the time? They will say, yes. They're not telling you what the time is, but they're answering the question. And in this AARO report, when they said they could find no empirical evidence, you say, what is empirical evidence as opposed to anecdotal evidence? And they want multiple witnesses and instrumentality involved and all of that. And you look at what they investigated in their report, and they missed those cases. Levelland is a prime example. There are any number of examples of cases where you could get that kind of empirical evidence, and they may in fact have it, but Kirkpatrick never saw it, or claims he never saw it.
You know, they mentioned specifically the bismuth magnesium material. I'm well aware of that material. One of the fragments that came through the Art Bell deposit that was made with Art Bell, and they say where it came from, but I forget exactly where that is. In any case, I have had some of it, and I had it analyzed at Southwest Research in San Antonio, Texas. And they're right. there was no evidence of it being off-world in origin. But how? What would that evidence be? It was bismuth and magnesium. What was strange about it was its structure was very strange, because first, the magnesium is in a foamed state. It's not, and how that was done is not clear. And also, from what we could tell under a 600 power microscope, there's nothing holding the layers together. There's no visible adherent. They are very, very strongly adhered, but they don't have anything between them. There's no glue or anything. So that's, you know, that's in and of itself quite extraordinary, but they don't mention that. But they're not lying when they say the materials, the bismuth and magnesium, don't appear to be from off-world.
Well, I've always been concerned that we get a real, honest, good piece of a flying saucer. I mean, an alien spacecraft. We have one, and they take it to the lab to analyze and says, yeah, it's aluminum. You know, there's nothing to distinguish from aluminum that's made on Earth, that they cannot distinguish it. We've been through that a couple of times. There was a Ubatuba sample from 1957, I think it was. Jacques Vallée said not long ago that it was really recovered earlier than that. But at the time, it was said to be 100% pure, I want to say magnesium. But magnesium in that state didn't exist in our world. And then later on, Dow Chemical said, well, we had something that we were able to purify to that level. But then you said, well, how did the witness that turned it over get his hands on that sample? So there are instances where we've got sort of that empirical evidence they demand, but they manage to dance around it, or they throw enough mud at it that you don't get down to the important part. You're busy arguing about other things. I'll go back to Level Land really quickly here. The newspapers got off on this tangent where the Air Force said there were only three witnesses that saw the object. And Don Kehoe of NICAP said, well, he knew of nine. So they misdirect all of that sort of thing. And it goes off kilter that way. And we have the same examples of that in the Roswell case as well.
You know, you have to ask the reason for all of this obfuscation. And what has always troubled me about this is the one thing they never speak about is the abductions and the close encounters. And I've often thought that if they either couldn't stop that or let that happen, that would be probably the greatest secret the American government would possess. They disparage the whole idea of this happening. And you wonder if their motive is they can't control this, or their motive is more like what I heard Hal Putoff talk about at one point, where he was saying that right before the end of the W. Bush administration, there was a group convened in Washington to discuss whether or not to disclose the information before the end of the Bush administration. And it was divided, there's quite a few people, and divided into a number of committees. And everyone went in thinking, yeah, it's surely time to do this, and came out saying, no, we can't do it. And the basic reason they said they can't do it is, according to what I heard, is that it would cause a tremendous amount of trouble in the manufacturing industries in general, because these processes that have been discovered have been given only to certain companies without any open bidding of any kind allowed, and that's illegal. So I don't know what it is, but I think it could be maybe a mixture of both of those things.
Well, I also think one of the other problems, if we had recovered an alien spacecraft and we could decode it, figure out how it worked, we take a giant leap forward from our competitors in the world. If we could reverse engineer the UFOs and hear that technology to our military forces. We would be way ahead of them. And I think they fear a little bit of that as well. Not that they worry about our competitors attacking or anything, but worrying about that information, that technology leaking to those competitors by being so open about it. If you can suggest it, well, there's nothing to it, then the competitors in the world aren't looking to gather that information because there's nothing to it. And I think that's part of the problem as well. And I also think that we haven't figured out a lot of it yet. I think the technology is so far beyond us that we have not figured out how it works.
I agree with you. In fact, I'm pretty sure I would almost say I know that to be true. And the reason is very simple. We're flying around in, or trying to fly around, I should say, these days in Boeing aircraft. And we don't have anything like that. And if that was in the commercial world, it would be a different, entirely different experience of life on Earth. And it's not there. It's also not in the military world. And in any way that is significant. In other words, it's not deployed. And if it's not deployed, that means it's not finished. So even if they are having some success, there isn't a fully functional object that can be readily manufactured. That is completely certain. And what's also certain, free Dreamlanders, if you would subscribe to unknowncountry.com, you wouldn't have to listen to these commercials. We'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it, a new world? It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is, and it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there? In the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Kevin Randle, and we're getting ready to get into the issue of a huge issue that just literally flies in the face of everything in the AARO Report, which is an affidavit left by Walter Haut, the press officer at Roswell, written in, when did he write it? 1990?
It was in 2003 when he dictated it or worked on it with Don Schmidt and his daughter, Julie.
No, I think I'm looking at it. It says December the 26th, 2002. So it was right before 2003. Yep. Yeah. All right. Now, I think it's time to start getting into this. We talked a little bit before about Walter, and you knew him, and I met him, and he was a perfectly straightforward guy. But before this happened, during his lifetime, he did a number of affidavits about this case. Can you enumerate them? Do you remember which?
Well, I know of one other one that back in the late 1990s, early 1990s, the Center for UFO Studies and the Fund for UFO Research set out on a project to gather affidavits from witnesses of the Roswell case before they all passed away. We get both the video taped interview and a written affidavit, so we'd have that. And Walter Haut participated in that, and he was in Washington, D.C. with us when we did some of that work. And his story at the time was he really didn't know anything beyond being told to write the affidavit. He knew that Jesse Marcel had found the stuff, but his role was to write the affidavit, or not the affidavit, write the press release. And that was his whole role in that. Later on, around 2000, he was interviewed by a French company, I believe, and Wendy Connors and Dennis Balthizer were there kind of working their, working as ambassadors between the French and Walter Haut. About this, and he mentioned sort of off the cuff that he had seen the craft and the bodies, which is something completely different than he'd said for literally decades.
Sure is. He didn't say that to me, and I asked him that very question.
Oh, I asked him many, many, many times. I tried to trip him up with old intelligence officer tricks, and it didn't work. Just maintained that's all he'd seen, but he then mentioned this craft and the bodies. Well, later, I think Wendy Connors and Dennis Balthizer sat down and talked to him about this, and he described more of what he had seen. And I've seen that DVD or the videotape of that. And it was somewhat confusing. And I think it was because Walter Haut had, was in his 80s at that point. And he was, I think, suffering a little bit from dementia, not a lot. And I really probably shouldn't say that. He was confused by some of the events. I know his wife had died not long before that, and I know how traumatic that can be to someone. And so they decided they were going to get him to do an affidavit. And Don Schmidt was there with Walter's daughter, Julie. And they sat down and they went through all of this material very carefully. And Don then wrote the affidavit, which I have no problem with Don writing the affidavit. I mean, he gathered the material, he put it into a coherent form, and Julie read it and Walter read it and agreed that, well, that's exactly right. And then he signed it, but the condition was it would not be released until after he'd passed. So I have no problem with Don Schmidt writing it. I have no problem with that. The problem I had was that Walter had spent decades saying, well, I never saw anything. But there's one caveat to that. And I think I pointed out in Roswell in the 21st century, I interviewed a guy in the mid 1990s before Walter Haut said a thing about seeing the craft and the bodies, a guy named Harris. He was a financial officer in Roswell at the time when we can prove he was there. And he told me at that time that he had been in the hangar. And Walter said to him, do you want to see the bodies? They're in that room. And Harris said he put his hand on the door knob and then decided he didn't want to see them. The point is, before Walter Haut said a word about seeing the craft and the bodies, here is this lieutenant named Harris telling me that Walter asked him if he'd want to see the craft and the bodies and where they were. So that kind of validates some of the information that came about in the affidavit, because Harris did not know that Walter Haut was going to produce his affidavit. He didn't know that much about the case. He just was telling me about his involvement and how he had had an opportunity to see the bodies and didn't take it. I'm thinking if you came to me and said, would you like to see the bodies in the next room of the alien creatures? I'm through the door. I want to see them like right now, this minute. But I can also understand somebody who'd been involved in the military, and depending on what his job had been during the Second World War, that maybe he just didn't want to see any more bodies and just didn't want to see that sort of thing. So he declined the offer. But he would have been a great guy to talk to. Pappy Henderson, who was a pilot at Roswell at the time, had seen the bodies as well and talked about it. Didn't talk about it, I should say, until the story that Jess Marcel had said appeared in one of the tabloid newspapers you get at the grocery store checkout. talking about the crash, and he said to his wife, Sappho Henderson, he says, well, I've been wanting to tell you this for years, but I guess it's okay because it's now in the newspaper. And he told her to read the story, and it was about the recovery of the craft in Roswell. I will add as a caveat here, he was wrong in the fact that just because it was in the newspaper, he was now free to talk about it. But that's a whole different argument.
Well, it's such a strange business because you have to wonder what really is behind this high level of secrecy, because it's beyond anything. You know, I've been told some things about the bodies, but the conditions under which I were told them are so odd. That it happened at Lackland Retirement Facility, Air Force Retirement Facility in San Antonio. And I was there to see my aunt and uncle who lived there. And I was invited to go to a party, which didn't seem, it's the afternoon. Ann and I were invited, and there was incredibly loud music playing, which kind of fought rock and roll. These were all elderly people, and it didn't have the flavor of something that elderly people would like. And in fact, there was nobody dancing or anything. They were sort of sitting around. And then an officer or a retiree I didn't know said, someone's going to come up behind you and talk to you. Don't turn around. And I thought, what in the world? And Anne was over across the way talking to my aunt. And I thought, maybe Anne will see the person. Of course, Anne being Anne, she was busy with my aunt the entire time and never looked up. But in any case, he proceeds to tell me about the bodies, about as if they'd been autopsied, as if he'd been there. And then after it's silent for a while, my aunt comes over and starts chatting with me, and everything's perfectly pleasant. And when we got in the car, I said, Ann, the craziest damn thing happened to me. But what could I do with that? The answer is nothing. And that's why they tell me. It's because these guys want to get it off their chests.
Blanchard had arranged a flight for him to get to Illinois because his wife, the guy's wife was pregnant and she was about to give birth. So he arranged for a flight, and Blanchard's on the flight with him. And they got to talking about things like that. And Blanchard told him that there had been four bodies recovered. You know, I think it is one of those stories that what do you do with? Yeah, like the years, what do you do with it? I mean, here's Blanchard telling this other fellow about it. Robert Hastings reports on it in his book, UFOs and Nukes, or Nukes and UFOs, about that trip, which is the first time we'd interviewed Don, and I had interviewed this guy several times. And he told us some interesting stories about UFO sightings that he was involved in. He was a scientist that helped invent the atomic trigger, I think, for the atomic bomb, the Manhattan Project. So he's Chester Lytle was his name. Just came to me. And but he never mentioned that to us. And I was kind of stunned when Hastings came out with it and said, what prompted that? And he said he didn't know. He just told him about it. But it's it puts Blanchard in the loop again. It provides another high-level people being involved with the craft and the bodies that have kept that for the quiet for the majority of their lives, didn't really talk about it. So just weird stuff like that goes on all the time.
Well, of course, bodies fix this in a certain way. In other words, the question of are they physical, where are they from, and so forth, are kind of answered to a degree by the bodies, the reality of bodies, because then it means they are physical, and the biology, if you examine it, then means they're not from here.
Yeah, that would be the one thing that really gives you the clue. You've got the bodies, you know, the craft right. You might be able to invent, but if you've got bodies of alien creatures, then the discussion takes a whole different tack.
Yeah, and it also might mean that they're not from the past or the future or from a parallel universe or anything like that. And it leaves you wondering, is it possible to travel across these vast gulfs of space, or are they from here? And that question remains open. Let's now go on to the affidavit itself. And folks, this will be we just for safety's sake, it's all it's in a lot of places on the internet, but we've also downloaded it to unknowncountry.com, and we have it on our website, and I'll have a link to it on the show description on unknowncountry.com. So if you're watching on YouTube or listening on one of the podcast apps, go to unknowncountry.com and go to the Dreamland page and you'll find it. Now, he speaks about a number of different things on the document, which has 20 paragraphs. I want to read paragraph. He describes a staff meeting at 7:30 a.m. that, and he just lists everyone in it. And it's important that we read this and put it in the record. The main topic of discussion was reported by Marcel and Cabot, Jesse Marcel and Cav Cabot, regarding an extensive debris field in Lincoln County, approximately 75 miles northwest of Roswell. A preliminary briefing was provided by Blanchard about the second site, approximately 40 miles north of town. Samples of wreckage were passed around the table. It was unlike any material I have ever seen in my life. Pieces which resembled metal foil, paper thin yet extremely strong, and pieces with unusual markings along their length were handled from man to man, each voicing their opinion. No one was able to identify the crash debris. So that's on the record. He put that on the record in anticipation of his death. And I don't think he was much of a joker.
I never got that impression either. And I'll make another comment here. Don and I interviewed Bill Brazel, who was the son of the man, the rancher who found it. And he described the material he'd seen. And we have, of course, that on audio tape talking about it. And he talks about some of the same things. So here's another source kind of corroborating what Walter Haut had said. And it takes it away from the idea that was this top secret Project Mogul balloon, which right. is a ridiculous explanation. And clarify this thing. The purpose of Mogul was classified, but what was going on in New Mexico was not. So there was no reason to keep it hidden. If they, you know, we found pieces of a balloon, so what? You know, there's
right,
no reason
exactly.
to cover it up the way they did. So Mogul isn't a good explanation. But we talked to a number of people who had been at Roswell in 1947. Robert Smith comes to mind, a man who was working. They were building the crates to send some of this material off to the various bases. And one of the NCOs had a piece of the metal in his pocket and showed it to Robert Smith, and he was able to describe it in the, sort of the same terms that we see there. So there are any number of independent witnesses talking about this metallic debris. What I think Don and I have been terming molecules with a memory, the material you could wad up in a ball and let it go and it would return to its original shape. In fact, Bill Brazel was talking about how he had found a piece of that stuff and he got to playing with it because of that sort of properties to it. So we have that sort of thing from quite a few people who are involved in the recovery operation. And there's nothing in Mogul or anything like that we have even in our current inventory. Is when you get to the bodies, we have a reduced number of people who've seen them, and
yes.
much less information about that.
Well, let's now go on. We're going to now go to paragraph 12. Before leaving the base, Colonel Blanchard took me personally to Building 84, a B-29 hangar located on the east side of the tarmac. Upon first approaching the building, I observed that it was under heavy guard both outside and inside. Once inside, I was permitted from a safe distance to first observe the object just recovered north of town. It was approximately 12 to 15 feet in length, not quite as wide, about 6 feet high, and more of an egg shape. Lighting was poor, but its surface did appear metallic. No windows, portholes, wings, tail section, or landing gear were visible. Now, if that isn't an intact UFO, I don't know what else it would be.
I suspect it is part of an escape pod. And the reason I say that is when we get up to the well, the Brazel Ranch, the ranch owned by the Foster family at the time, where he found the metallic debris spread out over this area. It seems as if the craft had touched down, shed part of its outer shell, and then this other piece of it ended up much closer to Roswell in what we think of as the impact site or the body site. So the bodies weren't located up near Corona, New Mexico, up, I think it's really about 65 miles, but as the crow flies to where the debris field was found. So we can look at all of that sort of thing and wonder exactly what it was, but we have that pod that came down much closer to Roswell. And there are additional witnesses that talk about their involvement with the recovery of that, as opposed to the people who were up on the debris field cleaning up all that metallic debris.
Okay. We're going to take our last break for our free subscribers. KevinRandle.blogspot.com, the new book, Roswell in the 21st Century, also Understanding Roswell. I would get these books because, unlike the AARO Report, they happen to be filled with facts and truth. If you want to know what's going on here, it's important to get this stuff and to keep yourself ahead of it, because it's up to us. It's up to the people. This species, mankind's not going to win this contest. And it's a contest, in a sense, with ourselves, isn't it? We are trying to figure out how to face this issue of contact, and we have to do it. Obviously, our government cannot help us, so get the books. Okay, we'll be right back. Have you ever read Communion, or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition, very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us, because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full, in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories, into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. All right. Paragraph 13. Also, from a distance, I was able to see a couple of bodies under a canvas tarpaulin. Only the heads extended beyond the covering, and I was not able to make out any features. The heads did not appear larger than normal, and the contour of the canvas over the body suggested the size of a 10-year-old child. Did I say did not appear larger than normal? The heads did appear larger than normal. At a later date in Blanchard's office, he would extend his arm about 4 feet above the ground to indicate the height. Now, it could not be more clear. Bodies. There are bodies. There were then, and knowing the way this stuff's been handled, they might not even exist anymore. And knowing the fact that all of the material, all of the records from Roswell from 1947 to 1952 have been disappeared, this report, any biological reports and so forth about this, any autopsy reports might be gone as well, thrown out.
Well, I think an awful lot of that stuff would be secured somewhere else. I mean, if you have a unique biological sample, you're not going to destroy it. You're going to be very careful with it. Arthur Exon, whom you mentioned earlier, told me that one of the bodies had been taken to Lowry, in Denver, Lowry Air Force Base. At the time, was the Army had a mortuary service there, and they were looking for ways to preserve the samples without contaminating them, or one of the bodies that way. If Walter Haut was the only guy talking about bodies, I think we could dismiss it. He just for some reason decided to make this up. But he's not the only one. There are other people on Blanchard's staff, every member of Colonel Blanchard's staff, with one exception that we could talk to, talked about the thing being extraterrestrial. Major Edwin Easley, he was a provost marshal, the top cop on the base at the time. And I asked him at one point, are we following the right path? And he said, what do you mean? And I said, we think it's extraterrestrial. And he said, well, let me put it this way. It's not the wrong path. So here's a guy who was involved in the security on the crash sites and the transportation of the material into Roswell and getting it loaded on airplanes. Here's a guy who would know all of that sort of thing, telling us in a essence that it's extraterrestrial in origin. We talked to a guy named, I want to say Riley, who became the operations officer. And he was talking about how Colonel Blanchard's leave, he supposedly went on leave on Tuesday afternoon, which militarily makes no sense to me. You don't go on leave in the middle of middle of the week, unless
that would be why, because he didn't go on leave. He did something else.
Well, that's it. It was an excuse to give to the newspaper. Well, he's not here. He's on leave. But my point is, from a military point of view, you just do not go on leave in the middle of the afternoon unless it's an emergency leave. Somebody has died. Something has gone wrong at home. You've got to get home. Yeah, that's okay. But there's no indications of that. And Riley said that Blanchard was out at the site. He was out there as well. So we were able to put all of this together. So it's not just a single source on this. It's multiple sources telling essentially the same story. Pappy Henderson talked about how the bodies had been covered up by tarpaulins in the hangar as well. And so we've got all that sort of information from multiple sources. And we're supposed to believe that this is the result of anthropomorphic dummies being dropped in the area to test parachutes, or a plane crash that took place in 1956 where the bodies were taken to the base hospital. It's just a preposterous explanations. And I do not understand how the news media, a true skeptic, would look at the documentation of Project Mogul, which says the flight never flew, and still with a straight face say, yeah, it was a top secret Project Mogul balloon. I don't understand that rationale at all.
Well, you remember the press. Well, like, give you an example, the New York Times, their Pentagon correspondent, Julian Barnes, depends absolutely on the Pentagon for stories. If he were to publish a story about this that questioned something the Pentagon gave him, they would lose that. He would lose his source. So the problem is that all of these media outlets are beholden to their sources. And it's the fundamental flaw in the whole thing, because the Pentagon is an enormous monolithic organization, and they can push a button and cut any of these media outlets off completely from essential information. And so they will do anything to retain that. Therefore, they're not free. They're not free players on this field. They are trapped in their need for stories.
Well, I was in the car the other day, and I was flipping through the radio and heard the report. They were talking about the AARO report. And what the guy did was read the conclusion. Just the conclusion. He said, well, there's nothing to it, and here's what the Pentagon says. And that was all they said. They don't bother to look at the history. I think that if they had talked to any one of us, and myself included, Barry Greenwood, Brad Sparks, Michael Swords, Jerry Clark, Don Schmidt, talked to any one of us about this, we could have corrected some of the idiotic errors in the report. For example, they said that the Arnold sighting took place on June 23rd, 1947. No, that was June 24th, 1947. And we would have caught that, and they wouldn't have looked dumb for doing that. The one thing I will say, the one positive that comes out of this report that I talk about it on my blog, is I had done a book called The Government UFO Files. And in it, I talked about how there had been an unofficial investigation started at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Wright Field at the time, into this unusual phenomenon in December of 1946. December of 1946, 7 months before the Arnold sighting brought flying saucers into the realm. And I was a little bit hesitant about that because, you know, Wendy Connor and Michael Hall were some of the sources on that. And I was worried about that. But the AARO report actually corroborates their story. Said, yeah, there was a pre-Project Psi investigation that started before the Arnold sighting blew this whole thing up in the news media. And I thought that was kind of the positive that I took away from it. They corroborated that aspect of the history of the UFO phenomenon. From that point on, it goes downhill, but that was a nice bit of corroboration for what I had reported in the Government UFO Files and what Winnie Condor and Michael Hall reported earlier than that. So it's an important piece of corroborative evidence.
And here we are, still treading water after all of these years. Meanwhile, the phenomenon in so many different ways gets closer and closer and closer. What that may mean in the long run, nobody knows. But this is something real, folks, and it has a significance to us, every single one of us, and it is here for reasons of its own that, for whatever reason, our government will not or cannot engage with us in a dialogue about. So we are researchers and experiencers, in my case as well, looking down a rabbit hole like Kelly Clark, I knew, wonderful new once a month co-host on Dreamland, say she's got the UFO rabbit hole, and she's a young researcher with a long history ahead of her, I hope. Us old guys are all going to be kicking the bucket soon, so it's the young ones, the brilliant young ones, and there's lots of them out there. Anyway, what is it going to mean to them? Because somehow, at some point, Kevin, this is going to come to a head. Whatever's here isn't here just to sit on its haunches, I wouldn't think.
Well, I always look at it from a different point of view, that the government may never have the motivation to come clean, but those visiting certainly can end the discussion momentarily. Whenever they decide it's to their benefit, they can end the discussion. I did a book, UFOs in the Deep State, where we looked at why is the cover-up persisting? And it all comes down to money and power. And you look from administration to administration, they change. But the top-level bureaucrats remain on there for years and years and years. And I think that's part of the problem. They're looking out for their own self-interests.
People will always say, well, my presidential candidate will reveal all. But this has gone through now 14 administrations, including the administrations run by the two candidates that are up now, Biden and Trump. And none of them have done what they probably should do. John Podesta famously just after the end of the Obama administration said his greatest regret was that he couldn't get Obama to release the UFO material. And of course, before that, Bush wouldn't release it. And God knows what's been going on. I know that Lyndon Johnson had no interest in it and said to that any briefing about it should be given to Hubert Humphrey as vice president. So go ahead.
Well, Jimmy Carter was going to release the information as well. And right. I talked to Daniel Sheehan about that. And he said that, how do you keep this thing a secret? And Carter is interviewing George H.W. Bush when he was director of CIA. And during that conversation, Bush had asked, I would like to remain as director of CIA. And Carter said, well, I'm bringing my own guy in. And then he asked about UFOs. And Bush's response was, I can't tell you about that. You're not cleared for it. You're not president yet. You're just president-elect. I mean, So you see how that kind of works, that there's this motivation. And then the other thing I've noticed is I'm the director of CIA and you're the president, and you come to me and you say, I want a report on UFOs. And my response to you is, certainly, Mr. President, there are multiple agencies involved in this. Let me pull that information together and we'll get you a comprehensive report on what's going on here. And somehow that report never gets written. Other things come up, other problems arise, and the president's attention gets diverted. So he does that. The UFO thing takes the back burner, and they're
right.
Able
to- and there may be people who are making sure it'll take the back burner. Go ahead.
I mean, with Jimmy Carter, you can say, well, you know, we had the Iranian hostage crisis, and so that takes precedent. And was that engineered in some fashion to divert attention? I don't know, and it probably wasn't. But I mean, you look at these sorts of things every time. It looks like a president is going to talk about something. Something happens. Bill Clinton got involved in the Monica Lewinsky nonsense, which diverted his presidency. I think some of them didn't want to talk about it. And so they didn't really push for the information. You know, you look at the ones who push for it, and there's something that comes up in their administrations that kind of diverts their attention or takes them in a different direction.
What about Kennedy? Stanton Friedman was convinced that something to do with this had to do with the Kennedy assassination. Where do you come out on that?
I don't know. I don't know at all. I've read enough a lot about the Kennedy assassination and looked into it, and you know, I was convinced that Lee Harvey Oswald was the lone assassin, and that was the end of it. It had nothing to do with UFOs, and then I found something else going on that you know that there was a conspiracy to put people in places where the president might visit. And there was going to be an attempt in Cleveland, Ohio, prior to Kennedy getting to Dallas, and that failed. So now they've got Lee Harvey Oswald in Dallas, and they set him up to do it. And you think, wow, what kind of conspiracy is that? Is that true? I don't know. It's just something that I had read, and it kind of suggested to me that there's more to the Kennedy assassination than Lee Harvey Oswald making a name for himself. So I just really don't know.
Well, Danny Sheehan's going to be on this show soon, and I think I'll ask him about the UFO Kennedy assassination connection, because if anyone in the world knows, has got something to say about it, he will be the one. Kevin Randle, thank you so much for being with us on such short notice on Dreamland. And folks, stay with Dreamland. You won't find a better podcast of its kind anywhere in the world. And unknowncountry.com is our home website. And support the show and support unknowncountry.com by going to the site and buying my signed books, by responding to the ads, and by subscribing to unknowncountry.com. Kevin, thank you.
Thank you, Whitley. Appreciate the opportunity.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.